I know what you're thinking. Joey, where the heck have you been? And we'll get to that, but first I want to talk about the saltwater tank again. I've been trying to accommodate a new type of schedule for the last couple weeks, and working the videos in and doing this, that, it's been really tough, and I need a break. The best way for me to have a break is to just let me loose on a fish store. Let me buy what I want. Don't judge me. And on the topic of the saltwater tank, that's literally the only tank that we can buy fish for right now, or at least for today. But Tamara needs a bunch of fish too, so let's go fish store shopping.
So I'd love to get myself some shrimp and other things that can go in my little algae aquarium. Not little, but small enough. Ooh, I love these guys. Let's see what else. I guess some banguys could go in there. They're friendly. Shoot, maybe we'll get all them. Banguys. So the Bangai Cardinals are these guys. We're not gonna get any anything too crazy, but these guys are really awesome. Yeah, he's gorgeous. Just a yellow angel. I've never had it before. Who else? They got a coral beauty in there. Got one of them. What are these guys?
These guys are black bar chromas.
What are you catching for me?
Blue reef chromas.
Blue reef chromas.
Ooh. Nicest chromas you can get.
Yeah, these guys are really pretty. And their adult version is over here. These guys. Look at that. And there's another one. Whew. What are you getting up here?
Yellow watchman goby.
Yellow watchman goby. Yeah, he was really cool looking with that. Very intricate patterning. Man, they're fast. You got two?
Got two.
Or one. I think one swam out somehow.
Oh, jeez.
What is that?
This is a firefish.
Whew. He's on fire.
What's next? Oh, I was going to get some of these guys.
Pantheus.
Yeah, these peach ones?
Five.
Yeah, five. Yep. Yeah, they're nice. We have examples of adults in that big tank over here. Hey, Tamara. Hello. These guys here. Okay. Not you, Foxface. Not you, Powder Blue. Look, they all want to be on camera. Let's find another one, like this guy. Look at that one. Look at his dorsal. What's this little thing?
Tiger pistol shrimp.
Hopefully he grows. What was this guy, Nate?
This guy's a diadem dottyback. Pink and yellow. Did you just say lucky?
Yeah, you caught
is that
him like.
What you just said was lucky?
Oh, unlucky. Lucky.
You did say that.
And that's a cleaner ass. Can clean up the other fish, eh? Also, stopping off at Aquarica or Tamara. To get some scaping supplies, plants, some guppies, lots of plants, wood, you name it. Spoiled rotten.
So what did we get? Simple answer is a lot. But because we got a lot of new fish, we're going to be dealing with an influx of ammonia and nitrates. The tank could potentially experience. It's 180 gallons though, and these fish are this big. But this box is filled with fish that big. Benefit being is though that at the store that I went to, quarantines the fish for you so you don't have to, and they're soaked in copper for weeks before you actually buy them. But I did get a bunch of these things for peace of mind. I'm gonna put them in the sump. We've got a basic carbon pad. It opens up into this big carbon pad just to polish the water, remove anything in it that I don't want. A nitrate pad, a phosphate pad, and ammonia pad. I've also got a test pump because I wanted to try these out. Why is this wet? Something leaking? Hopefully not. Also got a test pump. Nothing's leaking in the bag, but this is like falling apart. It's a Ceche pump. I decided I'll give it a shot. It only does maybe 800 gallons an hour, which isn't enough, but like I said, it's a good test to see if I want to invest, because I'm going to need three or four of these. I need smaller pumps. I got some big pumps now, but they're just too big to go in the aquariums. I also like two outlets. Why is there two? They're identical. I guess I don't care. I won't need that gasket though. Maybe I should put it on. Comes with a gasket, might as well use it. Oh, I think because we can run it in line or in the tank. I'm running it in the tank, but if I were to run it in line, I bet you this comes off. And then what? You come off. And then that screws on. There you go. So I could run it out of the water or in the water. I shouldn't have took that apart. I don't know how to put this back together. Turn the flow up and down. Cool. Quick little gasket on here. And now if I were running it externally, I saw that they have nubs, but I'm running it internally. So I want to put these suction cups on it and suction cup it to the side of the tank or probably the bottom of the tank. Yeah, this can go on the bottom because look how high up this is lifted. So as I replace the pump, I'll add in all of these pads, but while the pump's off, I'm also going to start biologically kind of like adding things to it. I want tiger pods for natural foods. Look at these little dudes in here. I'm not shaking the bottle, they're swimming around. Natural foods, and then some phytoplankton for them to eat. This whole thing goes in, this whole thing goes in. So we'll start by turning off all the pumps. Like so, and then we're going to take these tiger pods. You remember, little swimmers. They look like sea monkeys, brine shrimp. I'm not going to open the bottle till it's near the rocks. And then once it's in the bottle, I'm going to push the top off and squeeze it all out. I want them to kind of like infect in here to live amongst that. This is a natural food source that will eventually self-propagate and live all amongst these rocks and on them. They do need to live on a surface. That was cool. Hopefully my fish don't eat them all. And then the phytoplankton, I don't really need to do the same thing, but this is apex pods. It's food for them. It's interesting because the whatchamacallit just came out. The sea urchin, who might want to eat them. But I wanted to grab a copper banded butterfly, and in such a new system, he probably wouldn't have made it. I was expecting this to cloud the water. You guys see me squirting this out? Now replace the pump. I gotta say that I've never owned much of Ceche, but since I got Tamara's filters, I gave these a shot. And I'm a little biased because my friend Jay also works for Ceche. So I was like, yeah, let me give him a shot. I'm a huge fan of supporting your friends, huge fan of supporting your local fish stores. But this pump is way bigger. Oh, the output's too big for this hose, it looks like. Cup of hot water, and we'll dip this in. I really gotta clean this tank up, and man, that sea urchin's getting big. Clean this tank up and, you know, really take care of it, but I knew what was gonna happen once I started setting it up and getting it going, and that was what's happening. I am gonna have an algae outbreak. It is going to look nasty, but you know, it is what it is. Now, putting the end of this hose in this really hot water is going to soften the hose up, which should hopefully allow me to stretch it over the larger output. But this hose just simply might be too small, or might need more time. Yeah, I think this is like a half inch output, and this is a 3/8 hose. It's just not going to happen. Okay, you guys are gonna start seeing how I actually do stuff. Yeah, I think, a little bit more time in the water, and then we're gonna forcefully stretch this out. That's gross. I probably shouldn't have put that in my mouth and chewed it, but that's another way to soften the hose up, is when it gets really hot. You can chew on the end of the hose, and it softens it up a lot to go over the weird things that I've done over the years. But I'm going to show you another thing. That even softening the hose, and even if it doesn't go, still doesn't go over, we take a pair of pliers or anything that'll go in the snout of the hose, push it in as far as you can, and then stretch the hose out like this. Now, again, I don't know if anybody does this. You don't want to do it too hard because you can rip the hose, can stretch it out too much. But stretch it out and hold it there. Turn it. Stretch it out and hold it there. Really good shoulder workout. That might have done it. We'll see. Nice little dip in there. Make it loose. Make it wet. It's not going on yet. I'm going to get it though. I can tell what I've done so far has made the hose a little bit bigger. The benefit to this and like stretching it out like this is that when it does go on there, it's not coming off. You'll have to cut it off if you want it off. But I guess you don't need hose clamps or anything like that. And I don't like hose clamps in the tanks because they can be sharp surfaces. Like that extra little bit. Stuff it in like that. Like, see how much this is stretching out? There's no reason that can't go over that nub. But again, this could be something really boring and you guys might not want to see this part, but this is like all these little intricate tips and tricks and stuff is how I make things happen. Everything doesn't work well out here. Nothing goes together the way it's supposed to. I just force it all to. I make things work. And when we start building that 20-foot long tank or whatever it's going to be, that's when you're really going to see me truly show you everything and how I make a lot of these things really happen. I think a lot of you guys will enjoy it though. Because I see people trying to build tanks all the time and they leak. And I'm like, ugh, such an easy fix. And you might even think, like, oh, if you don't get it on there far enough, it's going to blow right off. No, it's on there so good. When putting on something like this, the input of the pump should never... I'm missing a suction cup. Oh, great, it fell to the bottom of the tank. The input should never be small. If you're going to make one of the input or output smaller, the output can be smaller. The input cannot. That can cause cavitation in the pump, which means it kind of like creates internal force sucking it in and destroying your pump, essentially. Now, I wonder if this hose on here is long enough to just go to the bottom of the tank. And I gotta be honest, I do not mind this setup at all. Yeah, I'm gonna have to move this out of the way. Or no, I can just suction it to the side of the tank, screw it. I like that, then it's I don't gotta worry about the substrate because look what I just did. No matter what I do with that type of substrate, it's gonna make a nasty mess. So this compartment's completely filled with submerged biological media. This is tactically empty. This here is mechanical, meaning that it's polishing the water. So I'm going to go for the second one, although at some point that will be filled with bio balls. I don't have any right now. Technically, actually, I'm lying. It's going to be pot scrubbies. But these look to be about a half inch thick, which means four of them is going to be 2 inches. And I can have about 5 inches of media, so this is no problem. The second chamber is, of course, is the wet dry chamber where water like rains over it. These won't be submerged continuously, which means they'll never clog, which also means that when pieces or when it's raining on a spot it is clogging, it'll move over. And well, essentially what I'm trying to say is these are going to last me quite some time. I'm not a huge fan of buying chemical media, but for what I'm about to do to this aquarium, I essentially have no choice. Plus it looks kind of cool, eh? All right, so shut the pump off, which isn't even going anyways. I think I could just unplug you, pop you off. Oh, I've got sponge in here. My bad, I already have a sponge in there, well, a carbon thing, and then sponge. 4 inches, 6 inches of sponge is already in here. What am I doing with my life? That's cool, they can stay in there. Oh, it's a perfect fit. No, it's not. I'm gonna have to cut it, I think. Yeah, I have to cut it a little bit right there. Gotta cut it to size. You guys also have to remember that I don't really do salt water the way saltwater aquarists do saltwater. I do a lot of this stuff much differently. Yeah, that's in there good. I couldn't get that when I want to take this out. It's not coming out. All right, that's that. Let's see it working with the new pump on it. I think the pump's wide open. Yeah, we're getting double the flow off this now. So that's about 800 gallons an hour running through it. Of course, we want more, but it's still at 800 gallons an hour, about 150 gallons of aquarium. We're at 5 times an hour total turnover. I don't think it's turned up all the way though. Oh, it is, that's up all the way. Here, want some extra water? Tank's definitely gonna be cloudy for a few minutes. I don't mind when the cloudy go or the water goes a little cloudy when I'm about to add new fish either. It kind of makes you feel like it's a little cloudy. They're not going to be able to see each other that great. But dude, this is a super cool tank. I don't care either that you can see the pump. I don't care that there's a ton of equipment. I love this being here. I mean, I got to do maintenance. Boop, take it off. I get to see it as well. And it's like a conversation piece. Very, very cool. Okay, I like this pump. How many watts is it? Because if it's like heavy on watts, I'm not gonna use them. Ceche 3.0. Oh, so 700 gallons an hour. Still cool with it. 4 times an hour turnover. Ceche 3.0. 48 watts. So 50 watts. It's less than 50. About same as about a large canister filter, I guess. A little high on the wattage, but I don't mind it because it'll also heat the tank. When you get like big pumps in your aquarium, they technically help heat the tank. So instead of relying on just your heater, your pumps and equipment heated as well. But that's also something to worry about if you're in warmer climates. But for me, any type of wattage that I'm using, I love that it's helping me heat the aquarium. For example, these lights during the day, they get a little bit warm, like slightly. I mean, I could barely tell the difference, but I'll take it. What was I thinking of doing? Oh, turn the pump up. Just a notch, just one little tick. I'm running that wave maker at 40%. But by turning it up, I'm going to create a new, almost like a new ecosystem within. Everybody's going to be panicking. That's when I add the new fish. Now here's the exciting part. We don't have to acclimate them in ways you might think. I heat the aquarium gallery. I do not heat the aquariums. But when acclimating saltwater fish, and what I was going to do, where did I put that? It's gonna take some basic aquarium airline hose and my bucket. I was going to dump the fish from their bags, put them in the bucket. I was going to put this in airlined in here and put the other end down there. I was going to tie a slight knot in one of the ends like this, just because it kind of sort of kinks it up a little bit. It slows the flow. Then I was going to suck on one end and start a siphon. That is called the drip acclimation method. Basically, you're dripping water into the other bucket. When it comes to freshwater fish, we just rarely worry about temperature. But salt, we also, the other biggest denominator is salt and the salinity. Lux out, salinity in this tank matches salinity in the bags. They've been in those bags for about 20, 30 minutes out here in the gallery, so temperature. So I'm going to be able to add them as I would my freshwater fish, which is the plop and drop method. First, let's get another camera in there. Put this in there too. So the selection of fish going in here are all just simply peaceful fish. I don't care. I wanted a yellow angel. I wanted other fish, but I don't really want a feature fish. I just want an incredibly beautifully populated saltwater aquarium where so much fish and life is going on inside of an algae tank. So if I didn't choose the fish you wanted, don't get mad, but I did get a lot. We got to get these beauties in there first. Look at these stunners. So plop and drop, put your net over your bucket like so. Cut your bag open, dump the fish through the net. The water goes into the bucket. The fish remain in the net. This allows for no cross contamination. I also don't know if there's any more copper traces left in this water or whatnot, and I don't really want that in there. So, oh, I got 5 of these ones. Oh, just beauties. Just beautiful. In yous go. Oh, you pooped quite a bit in the bag, did you? Right over to the camera they went. He'll panic a little bit. Tank's well established. Everybody's fine. Actually, go in front of the camera. Yeah, hopefully they do fine in here. Look a little stressed out, but that's fine. Oh, and then my my goby, my golden goby or whatever he's called, just a beaut. He's got a very yellow body and then white spots on his head. And guess what I got him as a friend? Let me know in the comment section below if you know what goes with a goby. Check this dude out. Isn't he just stunning? I'm just gonna ruin it. I got a pistol shrimp to go in there with him. He's going to hide and the pistol shrimp's going to help him hide. Now, truth be told, I originally went to the store to get a bunch of shrimp. They were out of cleaner shrimp. They had other types of shrimp, but that's not what I was there for. Instead, I got myself a bunch of crabs. Every time I go to the city, I get crabs, eh? I believe, what were these guys? Emerald crabs. I got 10 of them. Nice little cleanup crew. They'll do fine in the aquarium. Get them off this net. Get off the mesh, bro. I think there's some snails in there too, or rocks of some sort. Yeah, probably some rocks. Got a big crew of them. Get out of the net, guys. Out of the net. I'm gonna have to shake them off somehow. Guys, off of the net. Yeah, I get you a 180-gallon aquarium, and you're like, no, I want to be on the net. Get in. All right, that's not funny anymore. Do they bite? Damn, bro. Yeah, and there's a bunch of them. I don't know what they brought with them, but they're like, they're little rocks or something. Man, this tank's gonna go nuts with activity here shortly. Oh, and a little dotty back. I had to have this cutie. It's pink and yellow or something. Well, he looked to me like he was blue and yellow, but they told me he was pink and yellow. Who might argue? Just gorgeous, eh? And then the tiniest of tiny pistol shrimps for that goby. So the pistol shrimp and the goby are gonna live symbiotically. So hopefully what I'm able to do is put this shrimp really close to the goby, but we'll see. Here's your friend. He's right there. Go close. Oh, don't get blown away. Ah, he's into the rocks. Yeah, so these guys come from a store in, I think it's Bedford. Oh, we got a cleaning wrasse as well. These fish cost more, and you're probably looking at the price tags being like, oh man, that is so expensive. You got to keep in mind, it's Canadian dollars, plus he's quarantining for you and using all those meds and whatnot. This is the cleaner wrasse. He's cute. He's going to clean the fish for me. I need shrimp though. We got crabs, we got snails, we got an urchin, we got a cleaning wrasse now. Man, the tank was just so clear and now it's all foggy. That sucks. Ooh, I've never had these. So you'll notice that you were probably like when I was at the store, you also were thinking, oh, Joey, you should have got this, that, and the other thing. I'm trying to get things that I've never had before. And I've always wanted firefish. Look at these guys. Beautiful blue eyes, pink body, black/blue/red fins. I don't know what those are. It's absolutely gorgeous, though. This is literally the largest saltwater unboxing that I've ever done with like a few grams of fish. Woo! See how delicate and beautiful they are? Just gorgeous. Oh, and then we got some damsels. I forget what they was called, like halfbacks or something. Some sort of damsels, but don't they look like panda waru? These guys look like they belonged in freshwater, or they look like us, like little baby Severums or something, eh? Had to have them. Had to have them. They only had three of them, and so I said, screw it. These guys are just adorable. I love them. Yeah, aren't they cute? The crab's everywhere, going ham. There's the goby right there. He hasn't gone anywhere. Sitting there in the same spot. Oh, he's coming towards me. Is he warning me, or is he going to attack me or something? Yeah, once we get some shrimp in there, all algae, nuisance algae at least, is gone. Man, these guys are cool. Everybody's just out back over there having a party. This is quite cool. This little trio is just hanging out right here all by themselves. Okay, we got so much more. Let's go. This is a cool tank. And I'm so glad to have gone shopping today. Boy, did I ever need it. Oh, these are more Antheans? Anthestrians? I forget how to say it. But they're pink. Or peach. But I've shown you in the store a lot of the examples when they were babies versus what I'm buying versus the adults and the display tanks. So I guess you guys could just use your memory. Five of these bad boys. One, two, three, four? Wait a minute. Didn't I have five? Four it is. Maybe it's five. I can't see them. One, three, four. No, just four of them. Utes. You can have as many of these as you want in there. Over to the camera they go. These guys were my favorites. The blue chromis. Woo! They get really blue when they're adults, and they are just absolutely beautiful. So I'm excited to have these in the tank. Okay, but as for stocking on this tank, we're done after this batch. You know, maybe we'll get a copper band butterfly or something, but that's... I've got to wait for the tank to get more established before I do that. Oh, I don't want that type of algae in here. Aren't they blue? Look at their black dorsals. Isn't that gorgeous? You can come out too. I just don't want this algae in there. It's a different algae that I don't have in this tank. I don't think any of these guys are venomous, so... Ah! But he touched me. That just freaked him out. So all of those fish were added approximately 3 days ago. At the time of, well, today, you're seeing this right now. You're watching the live premiere, likely, with me in the comments, which I really like doing. A couple things I'm going to point out real quick is I added in a few more pieces of branch rock just to give additional hiding spaces and to kind of mix things up. This macroalgae will grow all throughout it eventually. It's starting to kind of get a hold. And that's fine, but one thing that you'll notice in some of the videos is this stuff, which is a combination of like, it's algae and cyanobacteria. Very common to happen. It'll balance itself out. Probably within a month it'll be gone, and then the macroalgae are just going to spread throughout the entire tank. Now, since the waves are making it grow this way, I'm thinking it's probably going to go that way, and I'll have to pluck it out and bring it over here, but that's cool. One of the things you're going to notice, though, is all the fish are active. There are no losses. And they're eating right away. To feed these guys, I put a little bit of brine shrimp or whatever I'm feeding at the far end of the tank and just kind of sprinkle it, and it blows throughout them. Gives them lots of coverage, and everybody has the opportunity to eat. Crabs are everywhere. I need more cleanup crews. I need more snails. And I certainly need more shrimp, but other than that, I won't be adding anything else to it. The goby's home is right here in this general area. He's slowly, you know, kind of digging himself a little spot. I'm not sure where that pistol shrimp is. Got to be in there somewhere. But I think moving forward, as for other fish, I might get some more firefish. These guys here, because they're really cool when they have a bit of a school to them. They'll put up their dorsal fin and flick it when there's problems. It's really cool. Now, as for dwarf angels and stuff, I might add another dwarf in there, but that could be problems. I don't think I'm gonna add any big fish in here because I don't want big fish issues. Sea urchins over here. We might add in some more cleanups, but as for fish, let's just leave it alone for a few months, see what happens with it. And because I really wanted something that was low maintenance, easy to care for, but really fun to kind of look at and incredibly active. Like, look at all these tiny little fish in here. They'll all max out at maybe 4 inches being the biggest fish. There, I think there's like 30 fish in here at this point. So I'm getting to the max bio load. The filter that you guys seen in the last video, it's back in stock. I'll leave a link in the description if you guys want to pick it up. But everything in here is just working wonderfully. Just some basic do-it-yourself lids, my do-it-yourself lights, which are upside down plastic flower pots with an LED light for your house in it. I've used one of these to grow this before and it worked out beautifully. I just had to deal with a bit of algae at first. I'm going to hook up an auto top-off system to this as well. And at first I didn't think I was gonna be able to do it because of all the water flow at the top of the tank and it's constantly moving. But if I put the sensor over here, see how it's not moving? No problem. So that's likely where I'm gonna put it. I'll put like a 40 gallon breeder under the stand filled with, I'm likely gonna do reverse osmosis water because if I did RODI or even RO, I wouldn't have this. And that's because I'm using straight tap water mixed with salt and that's it. And because of my laziness, I'll have to deal with some algae here and there. But when you're growing macroalgae, you know, it's not that nutrient export isn't gonna be that much of a issue. We're looking at the tank as it's just kind of starting and as it's just literally just set up. We have so far to go with this tank and we're just gonna have to have some patience. But I was getting a little frustrated with the builds that I'm working on and having to move tanks and kind of shuffle things around and of course working a lot of other new projects into my schedule that I wasn't able to keep up on videos, to be honest with you. I just didn't feel like filming or editing or anything and I needed a break. And my breaks, if you haven't noticed, is I gotta go fish shopping. I gotta go to a fish store. This is, you know, where I rejuvenate and have some more fun. But look at these fish. Absolutely stunning. Let me know in the comment section below what your favorite fish is. I would say you might be a little disappointed in the selection because they're all tiny and I technically don't have a feature fish besides that coral beauty. But I kind of really, I'm thinking I might get that yellow angel or we'll see. If I stick to the dwarf angels, pygmy angels type thing, maybe I can have two to work. There comes the goby and the cleaner wrasse is all over him. Look at that. You see that? That is cool. So that's the cleaner wrasse and the goby's out. He wants me to feed him. And there's the cleaner ass, so he might even go over and get him right now. Yep, clean him up for me, friend. Yeah, so we might add in a few more things, but there won't be any coral, just macroalgae. It's just a very simple, easy to care for tank. And once I add on an auto top off system, which is gonna top off the evaporated water, I'm literally gonna be hands off with this tank. Anyways, that's it for today. This video's been long enough. Thanks for sticking around. And hopefully, you know, this tank might inspire you to potentially get into saltwater with simple macroalgae. I'm using basic freshwater systems. And none of these fish in here cost more than like $80, which is a lot, but a lot of them were like $5. I mean, these green chromis were like $10, $15, something like that. The blues a little bit more. I mean, clowns can go for little to nothing, but crabs, I mean, you'll get them on rocks if you buy live rock. Snails are so cheap. But yeah, if you're ever considering it, man, is it ever cool? I'm really liking seeing the fish kind of dart in and out of the grass and amongst the rocks and stuff. I think they're really, really, truly enjoying this tank. And it's a different spin on a saltwater system. Hope you guys like it. I'll see you guys in the next one.